Our next speaker is Dr. Ken Campbell. Ken comes to us from Union Carbide Chemicals and Plastics. He received his PhD from Texas A&M under Dr. Lunsford, studying methane coupling. His interests in Union Carbide include heterogeneous catalysis, with a main area of emphasis on methane conversion. Today he's going to give us an overview on methane coupling.
So I get to give the last talk here. I have the advantage of being able to walk around and stay awake while you all have to struggle through it. So there is an advantage to being last, I guess, to speak. What I'm going to do is totally different from what everyone else has done, and I'm not going to present a whole lot of our own experimental results and that kind of thing, but we're just wanting to look and see, what is methane coupling, how far has it come, what are the challenges we see, etc., and then at the very end give an economic assessment of if you took the syngas route versus the methane coupling route, assuming a very good catalyst, how close do they come? You start out and look at this. All we're wanting to do is nice, simple organic reactions. You don't need to be an organic major to understand it. We want to take methane, take two hydrogens, one from each, stick it together to make C2. The work, essentially Keller and Basine at UCC reported what we call the pulse or redox mode type work in 1982. In 1983, Professor Behrens and Germany reported essentially a co-feed type result. I want to talk about what's the difference between what we call redox versus the co-feed type reaction. We'll point out also that before 1982 and about 1979, etc., there was some Exxon research that was reported that actually used essentially the redox mode. And they used a platinum type catalyst with a calcium catalyst and a redox metal. Came out mainly with, instead of C2s, which Keller and Basine saw, they saw a tremendous amount of aromatics. Now what happened after these talks, papers, you can see here, if you plot the number of publications, and this is publications in English, not all languages, but just English, it's just taken off. And I've had the dubious honor of being the person in our corporation who's supposed to read all of these, so I can guarantee you that they're all there. What we are seeing now, though, is you might say that methane coupling is beginning to finally peak. And probably you're going to see it do like syngas and all the other types of research. If we look at the elements in the periodic table, and this table here is really about 3 years old, you could actually go back and start adding in these elements, etc., that have been used as methane coupling catalysts. There are not too many elements that won't couple methane if you put in the right promoters and things. That's what it comes down to. The ones, though, that do does not mean they do it the best. And what we find out is if we look, there's two catalysts that stand out right now. There's a lithium magnesium oxide catalyst that was first introduced by Lunsford. That catalyst has been taken, modified, promoted, etc. All kinds of research. It's probably easily the most steady catalyst. The other catalyst system, which is new in the sense that the last 2 or 3 years, is a strontium lanthanum oxide catalyst, wherever lanthanum is. And it's a catalyst that has very high stabilities, extremely good activities. Present, as a matter of fact, the Institute of Petroleum of France, IFP, actually has a pilot unit running in France right now using a catalyst of that type. They will not release any information, so we don't know how it's working. But there's been plenty of things looked at. If we look at what do we mean by the co-feed versus the redox mode, I will point out that in the co-feed mode, almost all the work has been done in this area. Very, very little has been done using the redox mode except for the work of ARCO. And one of the reasons is the catalyst and the constraints on the catalyst. In the co-feed mode, you really have a true catalytic cycle. What happens is methane reacts with some kind of oxygen on the surface. We now know we make methyl radicals. The methyl radicals couple, as we'll show you in a few minutes, in the gas phase and make your ethane. the oxygen from the gas phase regenerates your active site in that form. The advantage you've got here is you've got a true catalytic cycle. You feed your methane and oxygen, and your sites are constantly regenerating. The big problem you've got, though, is you've got gas phase oxygen. If you've got gas phase oxygen and you're making ethane and ethylene, you know that ethane and ethylene are more reactive with oxygen and methane. You have to worry about your secondary reactions taking off. It's also an extremely exothermic reaction. You've got all of this going on at the same time. If you go to the redox mode, or what we call the pulse mode, you have a couple of advantages, but major catalytic disadvantages. The redox mode, what you do is you actually use the catalyst as nothing more than an oxygen carrier. It carries the oxygen active sites around. Your methane reacts with the lattice or whatever type of oxygen it is. You form methyl radicals, water, reduced metal oxide. Methyl radicals, once again, will couple to form your ethane. But now you've got to come back with a separate cycle. Take your reduced metal oxide and oxidize it back. Now it's turning out that there are some processes that are nearing commercial that work with something like this anymore. It is possible that you could use a material like this. It's very unlikely, though, because you use it for a tremendous amount of material. Your advantage here, of course, is you do not have your C2s with gas phase oxygen. So you've got a better chance that way of controlling the reaction. The exothermic reaction is actually split into two steps, too. Got this reaction and this reaction, separate from one another. Your major disadvantage, though, is if you were going to do this, you'd have to have some kind of continuous regeneration, which means probably a fluidized bed. Now, when you start talking about developing catalysts for fluidized beds, you've got to be attrition resistant, which is a major problem. The other problem, though, is since we're talking here about big bulk commodity chemicals, the amount of catalyst that you'd have to have in this system to be recycling it is a major concern. And that's one of the reasons why some people say you could not possibly do this. It's just the amount of catalyst would be so large for a large commercial chemical. Okay, if we look at just a couple of examples to show what you normally see for these reactions. And the reactor system we use is more or less like everyone else. You feed your gases, you mix them. What we normally do is methane, oxygen, nitrogen, internal standard, or you could use air. Your gases go through your tube furnaces. Your reactors are normally, most people are using quartz. Some people have used alumina type reactors. Quartz or alumina, the reason for this is your reaction is normally somewhere between 700 and 900 degrees C. High temperature type reaction, drop out the water, go to a GC, and see what your products are. Now, there are two ways you could run this, is you could run it as methane and oxygen mixed together, plug flow type reactor. We'll show an example of that. Or you could run it, pass oxygen and oxygenate the material, pass nitrogen and flush the reactor, and then come back with methane and see how much of the methane gets converted by the oxygenated catalyst. Well, about 2 to 3 years ago, a lot of people, especially as I said, the co-feed study, started saying the gas phase reaction is everything. You don't need a catalyst, etc. Well, if you do the blanks, you can prove that although the gas phase does do a good job, and you can get either very high, this is ethylene to ethane ratios, you can get very good C2 selectivities, of course you can get very high conversion, and you can actually get a yield, a C2 yield of about 9%. These are some results we've done at UCC. Professor Wolf at Notre Dame has also done it and gets almost the same results, same kind of data. The problem you've got, though, is here's your maximum yield. And there are plenty of catalysts in the literature that are much better than this, up to around 20%. So the concept that you can get high selectivity and high yields are true, but you can't get the high yield and the high selectivity. Notice this high yield is only due to high conversion. Now I should point out, yield is conversion times the selectivity. Represents how much of the methane going through the reactor is being converted to C2s, which means either the rest of it's going to CO and COXs, or the rest of it's unreactive in the process. The gas phase itself will not do it then. One of the problems you have with catalyst is, like with the lithium ADOX, is that you use alkalis, and alkalis tend to volatilize out. You form the alkali hydroxide, etc., and you lose material. Your catalysts are not stable. When we were looking at this, we decided, we actually did a tremendous amount of work on perovskites. We picked perovskites because they were such good burners. We had plenty of activity, now let's see if we can make them selective. And we knew that alkalis, and one of the weird things, I guess, about this is, you take any methane coupling catalyst, you put alkali on it, it gets better, or you put alkaline earths on it and they get better. And that's just something, those two types of materials will always make them better. So what we did is we went with a layered perovskite, and essentially what this is a layering structure of essentially a lanthanum titanium type perovskite structure. But since titanium's +4 and lanthanum's +3, we build up a charge imbalance. So every so often we need a layer of lower charge material, which is our potassium. So what you end up with is you get these layers of a perovskite structure separated by potassium. So we actually build our alkali right straight into the material with the hopes that this would make it more stable and also make it selective. Well, just to show you what kind of results you can get, and apologize for all the numbers, we won't look at those, we'll just look at this. If we take our potassium, lanthanum, titanium type oxide material and look at it, we can get C2 yields up to 16%. As a matter of fact, we can get C2 yields up to 19 to 20% on that. This is just representative. Our C2 selectivity in this case was 42%, 38% for the conversion. Now the problem you have is if you go to the literature, you find out a lot of people always bragged about C2 yield. Everything was yield. Nothing else mattered. And the way you can always make the yield higher, of course, is to make the conversion higher, which means you just put more oxygen in. You just keep doing that, and we'll show in a few minutes that yield is not the important factor if you want to build this process. But one thing that has happened is John McCarty more or less took all of that values he could get about 5 years ago and plotted them. And if you plot conversion versus selectivity, you find out that everything falls under a 25% selectivity curve. It actually falls under, at least for 95%, on the 20%. I mean, not selectivity, but yield curve. 20% yield curve. Well, you can take that also and come up with what's called the rule of 100. And the rule of 100 says the best you're going to do is take the conversion and the selectivity, and they'll add up to 100. Now, if you took the conversion and selectivity and said, what's the maximum I can get? If they add up to 100, you find out it's 25% for the yield. Because 50-50 would be the best you could get for a maximum of those numbers. Here you can see we are not at that limit. We're only up here to 8 if you add those two together. And it's one way of telling, have you probably maximized your catalyst in these conditions, this rule of 100. Turns out that we can take this catalyst and get our selectivities all the way up to 80%. And our conversion down to about 15% when we do that. So we can approach that limit under different conditions. Some of the strange things about these methane coupling catalysts are one of them is the effect of temperature. For most oxidations, you normally do not want to go to higher and higher temperatures. You like to go to lower temperatures if possible. We look here for two cases. The temperature is increasing as you go in this direction. In this case, essentially, it's always oxygen limited. This is our potassium lanthanum titanium system. But notice, it's oxygen limited and we're increasing the temperature, the selectivity goes up. And you can get these to go up. As a matter of fact, if you don't stop at 800, this catalyst works best at 850 and 900 degrees. If you go up to 850, it'll go from 37 up to about 45. And by the time you get to 900, it's up to about 50% selective. If you do have oxygen present, in which case this example is, we've only got 27% oxygen conversion versus 50, you might expect the trend not to be the same. You've got gas phase oxygen, you go to higher temperatures, you'll see the combustion of the products, the reverse is true. And for all of these methane coupling catalysts, for some reason, as you increase temperature, they get better and better and better, up to a point. And that point at which they stop getting better with temperature varies with the catalyst. For the lithium magox catalyst, it's about 775 degrees. For these potassium lanthanum catalysts, it's probably around 900 degrees. For the strontium lanthanum oxide catalyst, the people at IFP say it's 950 degrees. before it peaks out in temperature. Another way you can sort of play the game and make your catalyst more selective, something, both of these effects make it very hard to compare results when you go to the literature, is to change the methane to oxygen ratio. So if we take this once again as the potassium, lanthanum, titanium catalyst, and do nothing but change methane-oxygen ratio in our feed, what we find out is, if we look at our selective conversion, of course, goes down. Because now you do not have near as much oxygen to do the conversion. But if you look at the C2 selectivity, you can go from 38 in this case up to 59% selective. Now one problem you have then is, with these things being different, it's very hard to go to the literature and know what to actually compare. Now one of the problems with the literature is almost all the literature originally was working at a ratio of two. Two methanes for every one oxygen. Your problem is, if you were going to do this commercially, you would never work at that ratio because of the safety consideration. You're not going to blow up a $500 million plant by running at a 2-to-1 ratio of methane to oxygen. You're going to be over here at 7 or above. So a lot of the data in the literature is very hard to use when you're trying to compare that. The other type of catalyst that you can have is a redox catalyst. We've done work on that, even though we do not consider it the most likely commercial type. And once again, we were working with some double perovskites, and we picked this double perovskite as a possible redox catalyst, mainly because if you look at the reduction, you find out that for the lanthanum, calcium, manganese, cobalt oxide type double perovskite, when the reduction occurs, you actually have two metals changing oxidation state. The manganese and the cobalt both undergoing reduction. And that's because that the manganese, the cobalt, and these are the oxygens being pulled out, and oxygen shared between the two. So that means this oxygen, taking it out, is going to be different from taking it just from a cobalt or taking it from a manganese. It's going to be a mixture of the two. We thought this would be a very good system to study for this kind of process. We skip all this. The way we did these reactions essentially was, put your catalyst in, 10 grams in this case. You pre-treat it with oxygen at whatever your reaction temperature is going to be. You flush with nitrogen. You start the methane, and then what we did was we collected the methane from the reactor at different timed intervals and then did a GGC analysis of those. So like we would collect between 0 and 1 and 1 and 5 and 5 and 15. Constant flow of methane collected into gas samples type units. The main thing we can see is if we do the blank reactor results, the blank reactor, you essentially have a dead system. Very low methane conversion, which you expect because methane is an extremely stable molecule. There is no oxygen present, so there's nothing to burn, etc. If we do our lanthanum, calcium, magnesia, cobalt material, we see that we do get very good activity. It's a very good activity for a redox type catalyst, but this thing is totally unselected. Makes nothing but CO2. So you might think, no hope there, it's a total dog. However, as I said before, alkalis do weird things. So if you take this same material and you put sodium carbonate on it, and the reason why we knew to go to sodium carbonate is the people at ARCO, as I said, have done most of the redox work. They have taken praseodymium oxide, which is pretty bad, put sodium on, it works well. Take cerium oxide, which does nothing but make CO2, put sodium carbonate on it, it does pretty well. Well, here we put on the sodium carbonate, and now notice what's happened to the selectivities. Instead of being 1 or 2, we are running 80, 85, 78, 80, 61, 25. Notice also here for this first one, we had a 10% conversion, 89% selectivity. There's the rule of 100. We'd probably optimize out that catalyst at that point. We also did a GC mass spec just to see if we were making heavies. And one of the other things about the redox mode of operation is that while in the co-feed mode, you will see methane, ethylene, some propane and propylene, you practically never see any of these other products. In the redox mode, because you're normally running at higher temperatures, longer contact times, etc., you do get a lot of heavies being formed in the process. Okay? And one last thing that's really neat which really made it easy to patent this catalyst system, is this catalyst does something that's totally different from all of ARCO's catalysts. In ARCO's catalyst, at their highest conversion, they have their lowest selectivity. So if you look at conversion versus selectivity for any of their redox materials, you'll see that this value would be, say, 78, and then it would go to 89. We always start the highest selectivity and go down. We see this same trend when we use any of the alkali carbonates. We've been all five of them. So we have a unique trend in the sense that our selectivity maximizes with our conversion, which is something that's not seen in our catalyst. Okay, if we look at the mechanism, for time's sake, I'm just going to show the real mechanism. The original mechanism that was proposed by Kellard and Messine was that the methane reacts with, this is an active oxygen, and forms methyl species on the surface. Methyl species on the surface undergo reaction to form methane, etc. Now this would be a surface catalyzed type coupling reaction. We wish this is what was happening. Because if this were happening, then you've got a chance. You can do something when you've got a reaction on the surface. However, if nature closes that out on you, and what you do is the methane reacts with the surface and you make methyl radicals in the gas phase, now you really are playing combustion chemistry. The methyl radicals in the gas phase can couple to form ethane, which can go to ethyl radicals, go to ethylene. Don't have it on down here. The ethylene then can react and form CO2. Or the ethyl methyl radicals could go form peroxides, which can go to CO. Unfortunately, this is the mechanism that's accepted, this gas phase mechanism. And you have a problem then controlling anything, because once your catalyst makes the methyl radicals, everything else can be modeled with gas phase kinetics. Except, of course, for the fact that the ethane could react with the active site, ethylene could react with the active site. Everything else can come back to the active site. Now, why is this the accepted model? And there was a lot of people who did not want to accept it. Most people, as I said, working in the field, did not want to have to accept it because it causes a major problem in that your catalyst is an initiator, and that's all it's doing, initiating these radicals. Well, Lunsford showed, I guess I can plug myself, I'm the one who got to do this, that from a quantitative standpoint, he was doing matrix isolation where he would trap methyl radicals coming off of the catalyst. And by modifying the system, we could run the reactor in an atmospheric mode. So we could run an atmospheric reaction, measure how many C2s were being formed, trap a certain percent of that stream, measure how many methyl radicals were being formed, and then relate the two. With a lithium magox catalyst, a sodium calcium oxide catalyst, and a lanthanum oxide catalyst, we showed that the vast majority of the C2 products could be explained by the amount of methyl radicals in the gas phase. So in other words, quantitatively, methyl radicals, C2 products are related. ARCO, of course, did a nice little experiment. It's just plain good old simple chemistry, you might say. They said, okay, we'll put a lead mirror after our reactor and run our catalyst at very high space velocities. If we get methyl radicals, they'll make tetramethyl lead, and our lead mirror will vaporize, will go away. They did it, it works. It's a nice way of showing you've got radicals floating around. Very simple. It says you've got methyl radicals, it doesn't say they're quantitative to the C2s. And then Cotton has done a lot of work using methane, deuterated methane, and regular methane, and he's actually shown that these are the only products he gets. You do not get mixing of the hydrogens and the deuteriums on the same carbon. And he says that indicates that you do not have a surface reaction. For the surface reaction, you would expect there to be some mixing taking place. Also, there are several kinetic models based on the gas phase kinetics and the surface initiation, and they are able to reproduce results quite well, indicating that, yes, the gas phase type model is the one to work with. Other things, as far as the rate limiting step of the process, was some controversy about this for a while, but Kant, using his CH4, CD4 has shown for a lithium magox, and I think also for a samarium oxide catalyst, CH bond breakage is the rate determining step. Lunsford originally thought that the regeneration of the active site was the rate determining step. But this appears to be very clear-cut evidence. And this is what you would expect, because that carbon-hydrogen bond is the hard thing to break in the process. You expect that to happen. As far as active sites, this has been one of these where everybody proposes something. For the lithium magnox, Lunsford has proposed an O minus. Recently, Goodman has said the O minus is not the active site, but an F center is, which is directly related to the O minus. So what that means, Otsuka for the lanthanum oxides more or less pushed the peroxides as the active models. And of course, for the redox mode, you would say your lattice oxygens have to be active. Now, they may be going to certain sites that are active, but they have to be being used in the process. One problem you have here, of course, is if you have peroxides, you have a whole series of equilibriums between all the different types of oxygen species you could think of. So to say, for sure it's this or this, is pretty hard. I know Dr. Lunsford spent, he had a terrible time in Germany for 6 months, having a good time, using Raman to try to see if the peroxides were actually the active sites or not. He's not recorded any of those results. Well, if we take into account all of this, what we're saying is, we've got this more or less 100 rule, which says, at a certain conversion, you're going to get a certain selectivity, and that's probably the best you can do. And no one's really broken that rule, you might say. Slight variations, you might have 104 for an add-up. What about it? Is it even close? And so now I'm going to show some figures that we've done for the economics of the process. For our methane coupling, essentially we have methane, possibly a dilute, and air or oxygen, going into our catalytic reactor. And so here we've got our reaction taking place, quench. We have to compress up. For all of our results, we're assuming our reaction's running at 50 pounds, the SIG. Okay? To do our separations, we've got to be at much higher pressure, so we've got a big, and I do mean this is a big compressor in the system. Brains that up, we can remove our CO2, we do a chirogenic separation, purge some. We, of course, have to recycle our unreacted methane. From here, you can do two things. Now, because we at Union Carbide are interested in ethylene, we normally would say, okay, we'll come out of this, do a deethanizer, ethylene, separate out our ethylene. Now, the problem you have is you have an awful lot of ethane in your reaction mixtures. It can be anywhere from, your C2s could be 50% ethane or more. So we can't just throw away the ethane. So in our process, we visualize a small steam cracker to crack the ethane, which we feed back into the separation to convert it into ethylene. Another thing, though, is if you were wanting to make gasoline, you could say, well, we're making olefins in this process, so we will send our train from here into an olefin to gasoline derivatives type process. Make our gasoline and recycle the ethane and propane and things back to the cracker where it gets cracked. So we're essentially doing an olefin. So if we were talking about gasoline, this is the part, ethylene, we built that into our system for that. First question we might ask is, how would you run one of these if you had to pick away? Someone said you have to build one of these. Would you do it using air? In which case, that's what we call our nitrogen dilute case, because we're going to have plenty of nitrogen floating around if we're using air. Will we do it using only methane and oxygen? Will we do it using steam as a dilute? There are some reasons why you might like to put some steam in. Or would you do it with none of them? Pure methane, a more or less ARCO-type process. You go down through here, I want to point out a couple of things before we go to the bottom. This tells me here at the bottom, for these four processes, here's your yields. And notice, the nitrogen and the steam give you the highest yields possible. And the reason for that is, if you look at the conversions, they give you the highest conversion because you've actually added a dilute to take part of the methane's place. So there's less methane, so you get a higher conversion. However, the ones that give you the highest conversion, this is 50% selectivity. This is 77% selectivity. So notice we're 77 and 18, close to that rule of 100 in this case. And this one's got about a 62% selectivity. So the two with the lowest conversion or yield and conversion have the highest selectivities. Well, if we take all of this, go to the economics, and I'm not going to spend a tremendous amount of time. I will point out the numbers you're seeing here are about 3 or 4 years old. So everything would have to be increased a certain percentage, but the actual ratios would still stay the same. Okay. We can see right off from a total investment case, nitrogen feed is really a big trouble. And that's because you've got to separate the nitrogen out before you recycle the methane. So you've got a big cold box to do this. You've got a big compression unit that's compressing nitrogen, which is going to be just emitted back into the atmosphere, etc. If we look at the others, though, the rest of them are comparable. Steam feed is a little worse. We go through here with variable costs and all this other things. One thing you will notice is here, once again, the methane feed, the sequential, they're actually better. They're a variable cost than the others. Go all the way down to the number that most managers say means something, which is the return on investment after taxes, is what we call it. Finally figured out what that was. You see right off, we want this number as big as possible. And we see the nitrogen, which had a very high yield, and the steam feed, which had a very high yield, are the two worst. Yield is not the important factor. Turns out the real important factor, of course, is the nitrogen gets totally blown away with this total investment, but then after the investment, it's how well you use your methane in the process. And also, this one here has the advantage of having a lot more side products, so it gets a add-on for byproduct credits. But at this point, we said, okay, this result here was based on a UCC barium chloride catalyst that was developed by Barbara Warren. So we had numbers like this. This result was based on what ARCO had in the literature for their catalyst. We wanted to go ahead then and make a comparison of these to the syngas route. Because if there's one thing you do know is you can do it if you go through syngas. You can't make money doing it, but you know you can make gasoline going through syngas. So we picked, instead of this route, and I don't think the numbers would be too different, this one to compare to a syngas process. And if you look at the syngas process, we're essentially just we're doing it slightly different in the sense that we do our regular steam reforming to make our syngas, methanol synthesis, but because we wanted to be able to compare this with the ethylene process, our methanol does not go directly to gasoline, it goes to olefins. This is using some UOP, very selective, good catalyst, make a lot of ethylene and propylene, at this point, butane. Quench, fresh it, and then go into a olefins to gasoline type derivative. Turns out that if you went directly from the methanol to the gasoline, and skipped this is not, this looks like a lot, but the actual total price of this thing, you find out 70% of this process is sitting over here. One problem with syngas is steam reforming is expensive. Right now you'll see that there's a big push on, a lot of research is going to be done looking at catalytic formation of syngas from natural gas. I already know of several labs that are starting to do that. And that's because right now there is a push to, we've got so much money tied up over there, can we cut down on it? Now if we take the two processes and say, are we totally out of reach? We find out that really the two processes are pretty comparable, based on our economics and using the methane coupling catalyst result that we used for the process, which was 77% selective and 18% conversion, which is not that bad compared to a lot of other catalysts in the literature. That's probably doable. You've got problems with stability and things still to be worked out. If we do this, we see the total investment, it's more for the methane coupling. We look here at the operating costs. Notice that the syngas is much more efficient in the use of methane. And that's because syngas is almost 100% selective, if you wanted to say it, starting with methane and going to your products. But when we get down to the bottom line, and we say, okay, what would you have to sell gasoline for to make 10% ROIAT, you find out that although the syngas is ahead, it's not that far ahead. And of course, these numbers have a lot of these numbers have more plus or minuses and more room probably for improvement than these, because this process has been around a long time. There is, like I said though,
research heading in this direction.
At this point, you would say that if you had to do this right now, you'd go through syngas. However, if you think about it, the opportunity is probably for a better result. A few more years of research or something, and right now, as I said, these figures are 4 years old. Probably with today's catalyst, there hasn't been a whole lot done improving syngas. There's been a little bit of work, heat integration and things. The two would be very compatible. All of this is known technology also compared to this, except for the reactor part. Separations and everything are known technology. But we're not talking about a totally 100% new process. Okay. In closing, I would like to acknowledge most of this work was actually done 3 or 4 years ago. Union Carbide's Industrial Chemical Division and the U.S. Department of Energy had a grant to do a 2-year methane coupling project. The lab technician who did most of the work, so this is really the person who's the worker, the studies are coffers, Eileen Henson, she does all the work in the lab for us. Don Bassine, of course, Barbara Warren, who was on the DOE project, was my group leader at that time. Don Best, who was on the DOE project. Two names I forgot, had to put them in. Joe Mathern and Gary Culp. Joe Mathern did the methane coupling economics, and Gary Culp did the syngas economics. And that's it.
We have time for a few questions.
In one of the disadvantages you showed for a direct versus a two-stage process is the fact that in the direct coupling, rather than the redox mode, but in the continuous catalytic mode, you need probably oxygen rather than air. Versus in the other world, you can use air. And how does that enter the picture?
Okay,
the oxygen content cost versus the methane cost, which is the limiting reagent.
The oxygen cost, if you look at it, is that the cost for the oxygen is not so bad, it's the cost for the plant. We would have an air separation unit in the way we built this in, and that I think was $60 million, which is a big effect there. The one problem though we have though with the redox mode is it appears, based on the work that ARCO did, you may not be able to regenerate your catalyst with just air. It's two exothermic. And you may actually have to have oxygen depleted air to do it. Because one of the things they ran into is you would think you could get around it, but can you control the temperature and things? And so that's it. But yes, there is a definite advantage there in the cost. If when we had those two there on that one chart up at the top, there was $60 million for an oxygen and air separation, and the other one did not have it. You have the problem though of the amount of catalyst you're going to have to have in the essentially the redox mode, so that you're going to have like a 10 or 20 fold more catalyst in one than in the other. So you're going to have this kind of thing.
Lots of solids in there.
So yeah, the cost of, and I know one of the things we always said was, would it be cheaper to buy the oxygen than to actually build an air separation plant?
You still pay for the oxygen.
Yeah, but if your investment cost goes down and you're looking at investment, it's engineers playing games, you know, with the numbers. But if you had a cheap source, a long-range cheap source of oxygen, you could buy it. So that would be the thing there.
You showed, like, for some of your catalysts that the reaction went up with temperature. Some of them had different maximums. Does that depend on the thermal stability of the catalyst itself?
I think it's partially that, and part of it is probably when the catalyst will start burning the C2s themselves. Now, like with the strontium lanthanum oxide, if you take just plain lanthanum oxide, that stuff you can heat to 1,200 degrees and you won't bother it. As a matter of fact, you get purer and purer lanthanum oxide. The way we make pure lanthanum oxide is to keep under vacuum to get rid of the carbonate. So there it's not thermal stability. But those kinds of materials, you've got to get up pretty high before it does. Something like lithium mag oxide probably is the thermal stability. You're to the point where your lithium carbonate is now molten lithium carbonate. You're going to be losing it. So it would vary with the material.
What is your comment on the recent results reported by Catalytic Associates where they used mercury salts and sulfuric acids?
Okay, that's where they're That's to make methanol.
Methanol, yeah.
And it's a pretty, it's going to have to wait and see what the true efficiencies and everything. They're going through sulfuric acid. They're starting with sulfuric acid. They're doing the reaction in the mercury to do it. It's all, what they've done so far is all small-scale stuff. Okay, and then they end up making methyl sulfate or something. And then they end up getting, essentially what they do is they convert their sulfuric acid into SO2. Yeah. Then you got to take your SO2 if you're going to cycle it and convert it right back into sulfuric acid. So you're getting a pretty big, if you're wanting to make a billion pounds of ethylene or how many billions of pounds of gasoline a year, you're getting a pretty complicated process, plus it's a homogeneous process.
Yeah.
It's a liquid phase. Which, you know, it's a lot easier to visualize doing that for high-priced, low-volume type material than something that sort of...
What is the theoretical way of predicting the catalyst? Focus on this, it is so complex in the
I think part of the problem is you're running at such high temperatures. Okay, you know, we were 700 to 900. If you look at the periodic table, as I said, almost anything on there, you can make it work to some extent. And most of them, you can make them do a little bit, well, not all of them, but a lot of them, you can make them do a lot better than the gas phase by itself. So it's the high temperatures. If you've got a metal surface of any kind, it will activate oxygen and make it active to do this. And then if you put promoters. So as far as a theoretical, what's really needed, there's nothing out there to tell you. I know with the strontium lanthanum oxide, it's really a strontium lanthanum oxide carbonate. And they assume the carbonate part is extremely important in that case. There's been a different argument.
Is it possible to deposit these all the active components in the zeolite and the
People have been looking at the zeolites. I know Mobil has came up with three patents. I think one of them was a zinc, one of them may have been a copper, I can't remember what the third one was, exchanged ZSM5. And there they were looking at passing methane and oxygen and of course coming out with gasoline type materials. None of those have been what you call really successful in that you can do it. You can get a little bit, but your conversions are extremely low so far. That doesn't mean it won't work, but there has been a lot of people, I'm sure Mobil has been working on that a lot. And the fact that they've only got three patents means they haven't found the magic ingredient yet or something there. But it is a way where you could, the big drive, we want ethylene, of course, carbide. The big driving force is to make gasoline or liquid derivatives. And so something like that that would be one step would be a nice, simple process. You don't have problems with separations like you do with the ethylene. And it's got promise in that way.
I have another rather fundamental question. You have compared two processes that are both very expensive. And to show that they are both about equally expensive. But what happens to the economics? If you just take ethane out and scrub it out, or recover it from natural gas and do steam reforming.
And
there's a lots of natural gas that contains reasonable ethane quantities, and it's just there, and all you have to do is conventional
steam. If I remember on one of those things, I said the ROIAT for the base case was like 14.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. At the time we were doing that,
mm-hmm.
right now no one's making money making ethylene, but at the time we were doing that, the ROIAT for ethylene production, in the way you were saying, was around 30.
How much is it?
It was a little bit better than twice. It's good. So you'd have to go a long ways to match that. However, in last year, with the price of ethane and propane doing what it did compared to the price of methane, things start running closer together.
Really?
The one thing, too, is our figures have a price for methane in there. And some of the big companies would say, well, we own our methane. It's sitting in the ground. It's in a remote location. It's free. And like in Saudi Arabia, they're flaring methane. So if you start taking out the price of the methane, then the economics also get better. There is no one right now planning that I know of to build a plant. I do know that the Japanese, who are just ending a three-year methane program, are this year building a small pilot unit that will take natural gas to C2s and then will linearize the C2s to gasoline. And so they're
doing that kind of thing.
It's an expensive ethane.
Low gas, which has no value. And in order to get it someplace, you have to make something out of it that is easily transportable,
sure.
Like a liquid, methanol or
sure.
Something
yes.
like that.
Methanol to transport and so on.
Exactly.
And there are other driving forces, like in the North Sea.
Yes.
They have to re-inject the methane. They're not allowed to flare it or emit it. So they've got a cost getting rid of the methane, which adds on to could we do something
yes.
with it. There's all kinds of little things that
sure.
come out as far as doing it. But the driving force is make it into a liquid is what the people who own
oh, sure.
the port source
sure.
Thank you very much. Fred, you have some closing comments?
Yes.
I'd just like to thank each of you for coming. I'd like to thank our speakers for excellent presentations. They were, to everyone, very good, interesting, informative, and I'd like to thank them very much. This concludes our 1993 meetings of the Tri-State Catalyst Club. I hope to see as many of you as possible in Pittsburgh at the North American meeting, May the 2nd. Next year, we will continue in the same fashion. Jim Palmer and Dick and I will have some discussions, but we will have, I would imagine, 5 meetings at the various regional sites, followed by a spring symposium in April. And this seems to work very, very well. And it doesn't impose the burden on any location of having 2 meetings. So again, thanks to our speakers, and thank each of you for coming. And we hope to see you at a large number of meetings next year.